Today, we've got a few folks from PM Studios. It's great to have you all here. Why don't you introduce yourselves?
Hi, everyone. My name is Michael Young.
My name is Paul Hartling.
And I'm Matthew Jung.
And we're from PM Studios, and we're here live on the shelf.
Michael, thank you, guys. We really appreciate you taking the time to jump in and talk to us a little bit today. I understand that you, Michael, have been a fan of video games since your youth. Tell us each, you know, what are some of your early memories that put you in love with video games?
So I guess, you know, I was playing since I was probably like 4 or 5 years old, and it was before the NES. My dad used to take me to the arcades like all the time. One day, he came home, opened the garage, and then he told me to open the minivan, and there was an arcade machine inside. So I was like, oh my God. And so he bought me a Galaga machine when I was a little kid. He just knew I was really into video games, and my dad was a young guy, so he was fully supporting it. When the Nintendo came out, I saw a commercial, I wanted it. He took me to go buy that thing. He would take me to Toys R Us every weekend and buy me a game or two every week. So I kind of really grew up just loving this thing and being obsessed with it.
What about you other guys? What do you remember the most?
So I really remember the Genesis and Super Nintendo days. Growing up with just both parents, I got the ability to play both. And then when I got a little bit older, you know, I traded everything in, right? So I traded in a Super Nintendo, Genesis, Game Gear, my Game Boy, when the PlayStation first came out. Traded it all into Funko Land and got the PlayStation day one. From there, you know, I fell in love with, you know, the technology and everything like that. So I kind of just stayed with PlayStation, I guess, from there to PlayStation 2, PlayStation 3, and 4 and up.
So how did that love of gaming translate into a profession for you guys? Was it always a goal to work in the industry?
For me, as soon as I graduated from high school, my first job was at EB Games. So I, you know, kind of really didn't know the game industry that well. I just really wanted to be around it. So I got a job at EB Games. As I was working at the store, I saw some of the developers come in. I started talking to them and I started realizing everything, and actually wanted to make films first. I went into films, but then I got scouted by a game company called UFO Interactive Games. And that's when I kind of started to, you know, realize how this industry worked. I learned everything there, and I realized I could do everything but kind of by myself, and I wanted to make these games. So I left, and with a few other people, we started to try developing games.
If it weren't for gaming, I mean, what do you think you would have gotten into as a career? You mentioned film, but
I probably would have stuck with film. I really wanted to get into it. I met a lot of people. A lot of them actually became somebody's. My roots were always video games. I just never thought I could get into it. But yeah, it would have probably been in films.
I mean, my story is kind of, it's really good to a point where I feel like I'm lucky enough, because before this, it was kind of just a hobby. I was kind of running a website for music games. I ran for the past, you know, 7 years, we were doing, you know, it was like a news outlet, right? Instead of like a forum or a blog or something like that, it was an actual outlet that I helped run. And, you know, prior to doing that, I was part of, I don't know if you guys ever heard of the PlayStation MVP program, but I really didn't know how to break through. So I went to PAX East, because I'm originally from Boston. I went to PAX East and got in touch with the people that run Devolver. From there, I kind of asked, hey, can I like help run the booth one of these years? I'm local, you don't have to pay me anything, just to get my foot in the door. So from there, I helped run the Devolver booth for about 4 years, 3 years, 4 years, you know, up until this past summer, where I asked, I've known Mike here for a while now. And I was kind of like, I reached out to him, I said, hey, you know, if anything pops up, you know, in games, do just let me know. And Mike responded back, I guess, back in August, and he was like, hey, dude, let's jump on a call. And from there, it was kind of like welcoming me into PM Studios, which is great. PM has a big history with rhythm games, and I fit in very well here.
Do you have a preferred platform to work with or play on?
I mean, we always worked with PlayStation first, right? So we debuted with PSP, and we've never really done anything outside of PlayStation until Switch. Secretly, you know, we were working on like the 3DS, the Xbox 360 back in the days. But for all our releases, it's generally been like PlayStation related. But now, you know, we've kind of opened it up, and then Switch obviously has been really good to us. We love the Xbox too. It's just we haven't been able to get much stuff out for it.
You know, you mentioned earlier the time you spent at UFO Interactive kind of at the beginning there. What was significant about that short time?
The good thing, right, was that it was a small company. So I literally got to learn everything, like from the beginning to the end, right? So I was like, oh, wow. It's almost like a movie. You want to make a game, you get a group of people, right? Programmers, you get artists, a designer, a sound guy, and you start putting your, you know, your ideas and your thoughts together, and then you just finish the game. Then, you know, my boss then would always teach me that, like, it's really, that's kind of when the Wii was coming out and the DS, and he was like, you know, it's all about, like, the packaging. So, like, the people come into the stores, there's going to be a lot of people who don't know about games. And I guess kind of before the Wii, and when the Wii was kind of coming out, it was that type of market where people who weren't used to buying games were now going to, like, a Walmart and Target and seeing something on the shelf. And that image that they see on the package would be like, oh, okay, I get what this game is and I want to buy it, right? Before, like, huge internet boom and mobile stuff. I learned a lot of, you know, about like the messaging behind the package and like the name and the branding and how to get it onto the shelves. And it was a great experience. I learned how to find games. I learned how to make games and I knew how to get it out onto the shelves.
Who are the Playmakers? Because that's a name that, you know, when you see it that way, we don't hear it that way that often. We see PM Studios, but in this little tiny text on your website, yeah, right at the top. So talk about that and kind of tell us, you know, really the crux of beginning that. What was the, you know, what was that first year like?
When I decided to leave UFO and try to do something else, it was just kind of me, right? And I needed some money. And so I actually asked my cousin Peter, I need some money. I want to try to make a game. And then he's like, well, you know, I'm not going to just give you money to help you out, right? You got to come back with a plan. So I went back. I started writing a plan that, you know, I want to make this kind of game. This is how long it's going to take me. This is how I can make the money back and pay you back. So he said, okay, let's do it. And so that's the P. And then obviously I'm the M. So that's kind of how we started. And we're like, hey, let's, it's got to have some type of meaning, right? And they're like, well, we like to play, you know, make things that people want to play, right? Is that our goal? I go, exactly. That's how it started, really.
I think that's the first time it was ever explained here.
Yeah.
How PM started and what it means.
Yeah.
I read that you dabbled with arcade gaming. What all did you get into when it comes to the arcades?
This was a time when I think arcades were starting to kind of die out. We wanted to make a game like a successor to the DJ Max game. Yeah, so we just knew that it was only possible kind of for arcades. And it was going to be mostly an Asian release anyways. So we made this game called DJ Max Technica. I was able to actually bring it over to America, and it had some success here too. And then eventually a Vita version came out too, called DJ Max Technica Tune. But it was kind of due to like the design of the game that, you know, we wanted to make. Just wasn't possible for consoles at the time.
All right. So it's clear though, from the background and all the rhythm games that PM Studios has been involved in, that it's just a given that if there's a rhythm game that's coming out, say in the Asian market, that the rest of the crowd out here, the fans are kind of like turn their head and look over at PM Studios like, you guys bringing this over here? You bringing that? Like that's kind of how that works for us. So can you tell us what you guys kind of look for in those games? Because you got a wonderful selection and I'm sure there's a lot more that are out there that you've looked at, but what makes you pick specific ones that you've helped bring over?
So like the DJ Max and the Super Beat stuff, that was kind of all our internal projects. Some of it had to do with timing. So Demo for the Vita. So these guys are, you know, pretty famous in Asia, right? They made Demo and Sidus and Voice. And we actually just reached out to them that like, hey, the fans are asking for this game, right? Could we, you know, work with you guys to kind of bring it out here? So, of course, you know, they're gamers as well, and they want to kind of support the gamers. So I was able to work with them. I got it. But at that time, the Vita was kind of struggling here, right? So that's when I reached out to Limited Run. I was like, hey, guys, can you help me with this game? And then that's the first time I got to work with them. They were really awesome. Reach out to them and they're super cool. And that's my first run in with them. And then, so I don't know if you know a little bit about us, but when we get our games out into the retail market, Sega is our exclusive distributor. So obviously, you know, they're a big company. When the Switch was coming out, I was kind of begging them, like, can you help us get, you know, a license, right? So we were actually one of the first ones to get a license through them to work with the Switch. And that's how we got Super Beat out so early, like in one of the initial batches of games. And then there was a game coming out called Musings. These guys were, you know, dying to do something for the Switch. All the other ones, we weren't sure if they were willing to port it. So they just jumped on it. And that was our first follow-up, right? Right after that, you know, we're not like trying to do a similar thing to Limited Run. We want to just help people out there, right? So Voice and Demo and these games were kind of out in Asia, and then the rhythm games. And the fans kept asking for it, and we've worked with them. So that's how we reached out to them again, and then made that one happen.
When you brought Demo out, that took advantage of the Labo piano, and everybody sort of looked at that and went, wow, that's kind of amazing. So do you anticipate more and more games, not just rhythm, but you can definitely include rhythm games. Do you anticipate more and more games doing something similar and taking potential advantage of Labo and other features similar to that?
I kind of hope so, but I haven't seen another game outside of Nintendo, you know, first party games that supported Labo. I would like to see it. I don't know why nobody else is doing it, but I honestly think that there will be.
That was a pretty neat thing to see that happen, by the way. I think a lot of people got a kick out of that, and it gave a lot of people another reason to bust out their Labo piano.
Yeah.
And I think we built it here at the office to try it. And man, we were freaking out. Like, we all got traded turns trying it out, and we were just blown away at how well it worked.
Just a little bit about that company too, the Rayar company. I don't know if you guys remember, but the Voice game was one of the first, I think, launch titles for the Switch, right, in Asia. Mm-hmm. And then that was the reason how people found out that there was even a touchscreen. Yeah, because they knew that was a touchscreen game. It got leaked out that that game was coming out. And then, so they're like, oh, the Switch might have a touchscreen. And so part of the Demo thing too was like, we wanted to kind of be like the first to do something with the Switch, right? And so it's like going to be the first third-party Labo game. Now we're kind of more in tune, right? And then going forward now, we're trying to streamline things where little things where we want like the price point aligned with digital and physical. I'm totally hating the price difference thing, right? I kind of personally want the same release date as well for the physical. I think our next release, the Sidus game, that's the one we really tried. So we're like, we want it out the same day. We want it at the same price point. But actually the physical, I don't know if you've heard, but it's actually a better value because for the same price, you get a free CD with it too, right?
Mm-hmm.
We're here for the collectors too, right?
And well, you are one.
Yeah. I would say more than the collectors. We're just kind of here more for like everyone. We want everybody to have a chance. Yeah. I'm into collecting, but at the same time, you know, it shouldn't be that hard to get.
There's two sore spots for me in the collecting world when it comes to specifically PM Studios. One of them you've mentioned, which is Musings. And now I can't find the regular cover, and I haven't opened my limited cover. So
I'll actually tell you guys something first, right? We've never revealed this. The funny thing about what you're saying right now is the pre-orders were pretty high for that game, but we still limited it, right? So there was only 5,000 of the first print ever made, right? The funny thing is the second print is actually even more rare. So yeah, there was only 2,000 made. There was only 1,000 shipped.
could be the reason why that one is harder to find. There's only 1,000 out there.
Do you have a favorite rhythm game? Like, even if it's not one that you've put out, you have a favorite one in mind?
Yeah, I actually do. And this is kind of the game that inspired me to want to really make games. And it's funny that it's a rhythm game, but it's not a hardcore rhythm game. But it's something I played and I just really started zoning out with, right? And I've been obsessed with the developer ever since. And it's Luminous. That game has really played like an important role in my life and I guess my career. So I'm super inspired by that guy. And I just loved how even like Tetris, he would take a game like that and make it his own game with his own identity.
So while we're on the topic of music, what are some of your guys' favorites? What do you listen to?
I listen to everything. I'm more of like a hip-hop and pop kind of guy. And I like electronic music, too. I make a lot of those kind of games, so I'm always around that. But these days, yeah, I listen to everything now because we are making some new stuff, confidentially. So I don't want to be biased towards a certain person or a certain type of song. So I've been listening to all types of songs.
And for me, it's mostly hip hop. I grew up skateboarding. So, like heavy metal, thrash metal, punk was, had a small piece of my childhood heart. I listened to all types of music other than, country. I can't do that at all. But
what? You don't like country?
No, not country. I'd say hip hop and rap, even though 90s, late 80s, 90s hip hop is, still some of the best. But I still, like to go to a like a metal show or, like a punk show or a ska show. I just moved out here to LA, so I haven't quite caught any shows, but I know the Misfits, they're playing I think next month.
Sidus Alpha comes out and is coming up in May. Can you tell us a little bit about the game?
So I mean, I really didn't play much of the mobile version.
It's a new type of rhythm game.
It's new where there's there's two colored notes, right? You have a bar that's constantly moving up and down on the screen, right? So depending on if the bar is coming up, your notes are going to be blue, and if it's coming down, they're going to be, an orange tint, right? So the whole thing is you just tap the notes.
When the line hits it. Yeah. Sometimes you would have to hold them. Sometimes you have to drag them. If you play with the controller, you would use the triggers to drag. You would use the buttons to tap them and hold them. I mean, you might see similar interfaces now, but it was kind of ahead of its time. It's not really a port. It was kind of remade from the ground up. And then we put a lot, that's not us, but the developers put a ton of secrets and goodies in there. One of them was, we just announced it, which was like the DJ Max collaboration. But yeah, I think it was all the stuff that like fans and players really, really wanted and thought we would never do it, but it's in there.
Although you guys are really focused in a lot on the rhythm game section, I've enjoyed some time with Mercenary Saga Chronicles. So first, thanks for bringing over a great set of tactics RPGs. Also, it looks like you've got a couple of other non-rhythm games on the horizon.
Yeah. The funny thing is, we've only done rhythm games, right? And then we wanted to support other games. We don't want to kind of just be known for rhythm games. So we tried the Mercenary Saga Chronicles and it outperformed a lot of the games, right? So we're like, oh my gosh. Yeah, I guess, the rhythm stuff is great. It is niche, but testing out like an RPG was way, better for our experience. So we knew that we needed to kind of try to pick up other stuff. I'll throw it out there, but there is 28 games in the lineup right now.
That's a first.
Yeah, so you guys are the first to hear that from us too. But we do have 28 games. We just haven't announced it yet for various platforms.
Talk a little bit about Horizon Chase Turbo.
Sure. So I actually played this game on mobile when it first came out. I loved it. Absolutely in love with Arcade Racer. when I saw this game coming out for console, I was like, oh my god, it would be perfect, right? And so after I got to play it, I just absolutely loved it. It reminded me of Outrun, kind of on the Xbox, the first Xbox. I really wanted to work with it. So I reached out to these guys, and then they made it happen. So I've been playing it a lot, trying to get the Platinum Trophy. It's kind of hard. But the console version, it has like a 4-player split screen. It has a lot more stuff from the mobile. It's not even a port of the mobile. It's like a game that was remade for consoles. Personally, I like the Switch version because you can take it on the go, and then you can split the controllers up and everybody can play it, and it's more of a family game. Personally, I'm playing it on the PlayStation because of the trophies. Yeah, if you're a gamer who wants to play, you know, with your friends and family, then I would get it on the Switch. If you want to just play by yourself, then I would get it probably on the PlayStation. It's a classic arcade style racing game.
So since you've hit most genres now, mm-hmm. with tactics RPG and a rhythm games, and you got an arcade racer coming out, when are we going to see a PM Studios fighting game?
Soon, because my favorite genre, well, back then, it kind of is still now, is fighting games. So I told you I was really good at Tekken. I'm super into fighting games. I platinum every fighting game that came out. And yeah, hopefully soon. I would say probably in the next month. Within the next month, you're probably going to hear like four more games from us.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they're kind of different. Yeah, I don't think any of the genres. Maybe one of them. But yeah, the other three are completely new. And then the next set are completely new too. And then completely new after that.
Is there a particular genre of game that you haven't published that you're really looking forward to? Like, is fighting like the biggest one you're looking forward to, or is there a different one?
Honestly, if I were to do fighting, you know, not like hating on the Switch, but I would kind of target the PS4 first. I think the crowd that I like is really there for fighting games.
Sure.
And then I personally enjoy it more on the PlayStation as well, right? Except for Killer Instinct on the Xbox, of course. But if I were to choose a genre, I think we've almost covered a lot.
Yeah.
I think the one that would be the biggest challenge that I would want would be like a full RPG, because of all the localization and...
So my final question is, outside of gaming, what other like interests and hobbies do you guys have?
So sadly for me, I don't do anything but play video games, right? And watch movies. I cannot watch a TV show anymore. I don't know why. Like, I wanted films, right? I just absolutely cannot watch a TV show. Like, I can't even get through one episode of a TV show. The only thing I'll do now is just go watch a movie in the theater with my wife. I just started learning golf like a week ago because everybody wants to play golf these days. Or, you know, for work, everybody wants to play golf and I look like an idiot.
And for myself, I mean, I just moved to Los Angeles, well, Anaheim, but friends that I've known forever that I'm staying with, they're all, you know, food people, right? So I'm getting my fair taste of, you know, going to a bunch of food spots and checking out, you know, what's hot, what's good around Los Angeles. You know, fashion, I've been into fashion and I used streetwear clothing my whole life. So that's what I kind of do in my off time.
Well, I want to thank all of you for, we definitely really appreciate you guys taking some time to spend some time with us and really share your story of what PM Studios is all about and what you bring in. And do you guys have anything else that we haven't covered that you want to share with the listeners or the fans? Anything else you want to say?
No, except we just want to thank everybody for supporting us, and we want to thank you guys. We're really grateful. It's a small company. We've been around for a while, and we're kind of trying to do stuff for fans, and hopefully, you know, we survive long enough to keep helping everybody. But yeah, we're just really grateful to even be around still. And it's really because of all you guys. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it's a mutual appreciation. We think everybody's really going to love talking, hearing us talk to you guys and getting to hear what you have to share and hearing the history. So thank you. And we'd love to have you on again at some point in the future.
Cool. Thank you guys. We'd be honored.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, this is Sirius from On the Shelf. And Sol and I would like to thank you for listening to this excerpt of our interview with PM Studios. This was just a small snippet, but you can hear the whole thing by tuning into our podcast. You can find it on SoundCloud, iTunes, Google Play, CastBox, TuneIn, pretty much anywhere we can be. Links are available on our website at ontheshelf.media. Thanks again, and we'll see you next time.